Thank you very much. And that's quite a hard act to follow. For those of you who are in the room just before, an extremely engaging and interesting presentation. First of all, a very warm welcome to everybody from Amati to this wonderful event, Mello 2014. I have three colleagues of mine with me here. And when David first told me he was thinking about putting this on, and we've got to know David quite well, really, over the last couple of years, I guess, I said to him straight away, fantastic idea. Just tell us what you want us to do. We'll support it in whatever way we can. And so it's a real pleasure to be here. I was thinking of what sort of analogy, in sort of wondering what kind of thing David would be dreaming up. And the image that came to my mind as I was thinking about what this event was really going to be like was, I think we might subtitle this event, The Woodstock of Smaller Companies, UK Smaller Companies. So with that in mind, I thought I'd bring up this wonderful picture from the 60s. And of course, I was only just born when this happened in 1969, and so I'm not old enough to remember anything about it. But it was billed intriguingly as an Aquarian exposition, 3 days of peace and music. And remember the Age of Aquarius, in which over a rainy 3 day period, 32 acts performed in front of 400,000 young people, causing mayhem on the surrounding roads. The comparisons to Mello 2014 are clear. At Mello 2014, we're approximately 400,000 youthful and hope-filled idealists celebrating 3 days of peace and enterprise, looking forward to tomorrow when those in whom we've invested our trust and our dreams will do everything we expected and more, making the world a better place and giving us financial security forever and ever, amen. Let it never be said that the world of stock market research drifts into the realms of fantasy. Before I get hopelessly unstuck with this analogy, let us recall one or two of the other events from 1969, which was really the overripe end of the 1960s individualism. So less than 1 month before Woodstock took place, this happened. Neil Armstrong and his colleague landed on the moon. A month afterwards, having already given their last public concert, the Beatles crossed this particular zebra crossing in London. And this was a year after the assassination of Martin Luther King, and it was a year when the protest against the hopeless and cruel war in Vietnam erupted into a mass movement amidst the election of Nixon in the US in January. The following year, these rallies would turn violent and protests would turn into bombings. Now, 1969 was also had for investors such as us. Another significant thing happened in 1969, and at this point I've got a quiz. Who recognises this individual here? You're not allowed to answer. any takers? Warren Buffett, thank you, Stuart. It was the young Warren Buffett. I'm not sure this is exactly 1969, but it gives you the flavour. And of course, this is him, which is amazingly characteristic of the man. When he was this age, he used to give evening classes to educate people about investment. And I think he did that pretty much voluntarily. But in 1969, interestingly, it was the year that he folded his partnership, and it was the partnership that really made him a very, very, very wealthy man. One of the interesting things about, well, there's a number of interesting things about the partnership, which had been running 15 years maybe over that period when he decided to fold it. First interesting thing, it had risen 30 times in value over that period. Of course, it was a strong period in the stock market. The fee structure of the partnership was a performance fee. It was a 50% performance fee. But interestingly, it's very, very aggressive, you might think, but interestingly, he also offered you a guarantee, so he would pay 25% of any losses he made on your behalf. It's not something that's been very widely copied. And in 1969, something must have told this young gentleman that Mr. Market was just a little bit too exuberant. And whatever his reasoning was, he wrote to the partners and said, I'm closing down the partnership. Here's your money back. I think you'd be better off doing something else for the next few years. And of course, he was exactly right. The market fell about 35% in the following year. It then hit the early 70s, and 74, we had the oil crisis. Market was down 45% from 1969 days. And then he said, wrote to people and said, now's a good time to invest again. Of course, what's interesting about that for us is Warren Buffett, of course, is the, you know, he's best known for the phrase, the best time to sell is never. And he's not very highly critical of people timing the market. It's one of those things we just have to ponder, and it's a question that's interesting. It's not the question I'm going to answer today, though. So what today's subject is the zoology of aim. And in a recent article I noticed in the FT, I don't know if anyone saw this, but they were talking about the AIM market, and the headline of the article was Muppet Market. And of course, you know, for those of us who invest in AIM, this is, you know, this is somewhat, you know, disappointing to see such headlines. At Amati, we run small companies fund, we run some VCTs, we're a small cap investment specialist, that's all we do. Our small companies fund typically has between 50 and 60% of its assets in the AIM market, and we don't have to do that, we have no obligation to be in AIM. We do it because we actually like it as a market, or rather I should say we like parts of it, and we have no necessity to be there at all. Of course, we like it because we think it has some very good, well-managed growth companies. That's what we're after. But of course, it does have its vipers, and it has its chameleons, and it has its masters of camouflage and disguise. These, as any good zookeeper will tell you, need handling with a good deal of caution and care. So what I want to cover in under this heading of zoology is really to provide some classifications that might prove useful in negotiating your way around this market, and to argue that what might be a bad market for Muppets might be a good one for zoologists. So we're going to make some basic assumption here. This is straight from the biology book. I'm going to make a basic assumption here that when a company goes through that process of investing, of listing on the AIM market, it hires a bunch of lawyers, it hires some accountants, they trawl through the books. And I'm going to call this a backbone. So we're really only interested in this category of vertebrates here. So if you're on AIM, you've got a backbone, we hope. So this leaves us with five classes of animal. It's an elaborate metaphor, but bear with me. So we have these five categories here. So we're going to start with fish. Now, we've heard a bit about fish already today, and fish essentially are animals that live in a different world from us. And by that, what I mean is these are the companies that are operating under different legal systems, different cultures, under different norms. I'm being unashamedly relativistic here. So, of course, what one person's fish is another person is a different animal for another person. So, for me, for example, and for probably most of us here, if we're investing in Chinese businesses, and this topic has come up earlier, we're investing in fish. You get the picture. I'm going to just go on to a little bit of my scrapbook here, just to show that. When I say this, I'm not trying to be sort of Little Englander about it at all and say, you know, let's just ignore everything outside of the world. In our time, we've done a good deal of fishing, and most small cap fund managers go through this at some point in their career. So here's a few of my fishing expeditions, and this one was to China in 2007. And this was a wonderful research trip I did with a delegation from Europe. And here we are meeting a company around the table. This is us outside the Shanghai Stock Exchange in 2007. On the far left of this picture is a former ambassador to China from Britain, extremely knowledgeable man. And standing next to him is a businessman from, I think he was from the States, and he'd worked in China for over 20 years and had a very good understanding of the place and what it was like to do business there. And here we are visiting a company that some of you may remember, which went by the name of Rennie Solar. Does anybody here remember Rennie Solar? Stuart remembers it. If you're a fund manager in 2007, you remember it. It was one of the darling stocks, really, of 2007. And a journal called This Is Money reported. I went in July, and the reason we went here is this was quite a controversial company, and we were a little bit suspicious trying to understand it. It had floated at 79p. The shares had gone up to about £5. And to me, there are a number of things that really made me scratch my head about this business. I won't bore you with all the detail now, but This Is Money reported on the 24th of August after the company issued a profit warning. Hello, is anyone there? The silence from the financial PR advisors to Rennie Solar was deafening as the former AIM go-go stock hit the market with yet more bad news. For a short time, it was the biggest Chinese company on AIM. As far as many investors are now concerned, the sun ain't going to shine anymore for Rennie Solar. The downgrade in estimated production output was blamed on the late delivery of new crucibles. And I should say what Reni Solar did, because nobody here remembers it, they came to market with this proposition that they would reclaim silicon from all kinds of scrap silicon wafers, and they would use the reclaimed silicon to make solar panels. That's why it's called Reni Solar. And they claimed they had some very latest technology for doing it. Of course, when we went around the factory, we saw that the technology for doing that was 900 women between the age of 25 and 30 in a big factory hand-picking out bits of silicon they could use, testing it, that one goes there, that one goes there. And actually, this visit for me was probably the single most eye-opening visit I made in China that year. It was fascinating. So that's fishing, and that's fish. I hope that's sort of clear enough. So next we have amphibians. Now, this is a group of companies which have many of the features of fish. So they, if you like, operate in parts of the world which are under different legal systems, different cultures, different expectations. But if you like, they form themselves in such a way that's much easier for us to identify with. So they're probably run by boards of directors in the UK. They probably voluntarily adopt the UK takeover code. That's pretty important, or something to look at if you're dealing with a non-UK registered entity that's listed in London. Is it subject to the UK takeover code or not? They will voluntarily take on some of the obligations of the UK corporate governance code and so on. And these things are a big deal. Of course, amphibians, if you think about it, and this was a larger part of the AIM market than it is now, it covers the majority of natural resources businesses on the market. And so I've brought in a couple of them here. I think anyone who's spent a long time as a small cap fund manager in London will have had a lot of experience of the natural resources end of the market. It was a boom market from about 2002 to 2007. It was an interesting place to invest. It was a roller coaster ride, and we were essentially dealing with, in some cases, fish, mostly amphibians. Good examples of these. I'm thinking of companies we've owned. Amerisur, for example, the oil company, operates entirely in Colombia. It actually operates in the area of Colombia which is worst afflicted by gorillas, and it's all right on the border with Ecuador. The gorillas actually who operate in this area live over the river in Ecuador, and then they come over to Colombia, cause mayhem, and go back again. Amerisur has operated in that area successfully for a long time. It does so with a lot of protection from the government, and it's an amphibian. These are people we know well. They live in the UK. They come and keep us updated very regularly. If things go wrong, we hear about it. That's one of the very important things, and it's one of the things, characteristics of fish. You can never get, if things go wrong, you tend not to hear about it, which is why that quote from This Is Money is important about is anyone there? The silence is deafening. One other example of an amphibian in our portfolio in our small cap is Central Asian Metals. I don't know if anyone knows that business. It's a copper mining stock. It's actually proven to be very, very successful. It operates in Central Asia, Kazakhstan. It's one of a small number of companies that have really made a very successful business in that area. Extremely difficult to do right now. These are tiny parts of our portfolio. At other times, they may be more significant. So after amphibians, the next category that we're going to move on to have a look at is reptiles. And now reptiles came up a little bit in the panel we were speaking about earlier. And reptiles are really one of the things that make investing on AIM challenging. And so really what reptiles are cold-blooded. They have no empathy with you as an investor. They're not interested in you as an investor. They are out to do one thing and one thing only, and that's serve their own interests and gobble up everything around them that they can find. These are not friendly creatures. That one on the left there is a Komodo dragon, in case anyone was wondering. And Komodo dragons have this horrible way of capturing their prey. They gang up, and one of them bites the prey only once, and then they just wait, because the bite is poisonous. And after 2 weeks, or a week, or a number of days, the prey loses all strength, and then they go and devour it. And I suppose this is a little bit like a company. The analogy for a company really is, you know, if you're bitten by a Komodo dragon, you just lose all sense really of what might be wrong with the company. You can only see the good qualities that are being thrown at you, and you completely miss the fact that there were some clear signals over here which were telling you that this was really quite a dangerous beast. Now, detecting these things is difficult. And of course, you know, I suppose we have to go into slightly into the realms of fantasy here. These reptiles don't come up to you and say, "I'm a reptile, would you like to invest?" They pretend to be something else. And they are very expert at looking like something else. So our job, if you like, as investors and fund managers, is to be as good as we can at uncovering these things and to do so early enough. There's lots of different ways of doing this. I'm not going to go through the whole list, but one thing we're going to look at today, which I think some people may find interesting, is this particular reptile hunter here, whose name was Professor Beanish, and he published a paper in 1999. And he was really interested in uncovering these things using statistics. It's not typically what we do as investors. I mean, we certainly at Amati, we tend to like to think we can figure things out, and we read the RNSs carefully, and we look at all the documentation, and we look for evidence, if you like, fundamental evidence of the tendency to misbehave in managing companies. And I should just take one little step back here, because actually the reason why these things exist is it's fundamentally to do with a basic conflict of interest in managing a public company between the board of directors and the investors. And in order to analyze this at its most fundamental level, you need to understand that conflict of interest. And so what you require as investors are a management team who understand that conflict and who are committed to serving your interests above their own. They don't have to, but you need managers who are committed to doing that. It's not everybody who is willing to do that. But that's the fundamental conflict. So Professor Beanish was a professor of accountancy, and he set out to look for a statistical method. He said, okay, there must be some, these things must show up in the numbers. It wasn't the first to do it. There's the Altman Z score, and this is really the successor to that. And so he did this statistical analysis, and he looked at these 8 different variables. And I don't normally like putting words in slides, but I put these in just because otherwise we're going to lose all sight of them. These 8 characteristics are things which appear in the accounts, which he has found statistically these are characteristics through which you can, a company which is manipulating its earnings will tend to fiddle these things. So the basic characteristic of an earnings manipulator, he described in this way, says, I find that sample manipulators, and this is a sample that he took, typically overstate earnings by recording fictitious, unearned, or uncertain revenue, recording fictitional inventory, or improperly capitalizing costs. So those are the basic things, and those all things are all going to show up in the numbers at some way. So he went through these things. So, of course, day sales receivable index, receivables index. Here we're looking at the receivables this year compared to what they were a year ago, and obviously if that number's growing, then you've got a potential problem. It's the, you know, it's a basic thing we're all going to look at. It's comparing cash flow essentially. It's a cash flow item. So if your receivables start to balloon, that particular index is going to be larger, and it's a significant one in his calculation. And then we've got gross margin index, where actually what he found was that gross margins of manipulators tend to fall rather than rise in the year when things are going wrong. So the business is under pressure. So if that's falling, that's a problem. Asset quality, this is he's really looking at the tangible assets versus the intangible assets and looking at how they've changed over the last year. So if your intangibles are becoming a bigger proportion of your total asset base, that index goes up. Then we have, this is interesting, there's a sales growth index. Very simply, how much did your sales grow this year? And of course, those of us who love small companies, you know, the reason we love them is because they can grow so fast and they can be so dynamic and they can do incredible new things and take a market by storm, as a little bit like we were hearing earlier. However, sales growth is probably the single, excessive sales growth is one of the single biggest warning signs of an earnings manipulator. So we have to be very careful when we see it. Yes, we love it, but we also need to be suspicious. And you'll see in this calculation that he does, that simply the percentage of sales growth is a potential warning signal. Then there's depreciation. Obviously, if you're shrinking your depreciation, you're trying to boost your earnings, so that's an easy one. It's one where if the earnings, if depreciation has gone down year on year, it's a negative in this calculation. SG&A expense, if that goes up, that's a good sign, because you're not, if you're manipulating your earnings, you're going to squash that figure down, so your earnings go up. Then you have a leverage index. It's just looking at this year's leverage compared to last year's. And then the bottom one here, the accruals, and this is just cash flow analysis, looking at income from operations less your income from cash flow, in the cash flow statement from operations, divided by your total assets. And this is also a very important number in the calculation. If that number, it's not a comparison year on year, this is an absolute number. If that number is at all large, you get heavily penalised in this calculation. So being a professor, he didn't make this very user-friendly, so this is how the sum actually looks. And interestingly, the way the results come out is a little bit abstruse. I would not have done this way if I was him. But essentially, the numbers you're going to get at the end are all negative. And the higher they are, the less negative they are, the worse they are. So a really good score would be about -3, -2.5. Once you get to -2.2, it's a little bit of a orange light. You've got to be a bit careful. And what he's looking at is he's taking the percentage of companies which are not manipulators and the percentage of companies which are manipulators, which fall into these categories. So -2.2, you're a little bit bothersome. -1.78, you're well into danger territory. Around 75% of earnings manipulators will score above -1.78. Above -1.58, that's pretty much as far as he went. Once you get to that level, the red light's really fully on. So that's just giving you that. So I thought what would be fun is to go through a real live example here. And we've got one here. This is a set of numbers. It's a real company. It's on AIM. It's quite big, as you can see from the sales. We'll have a quiz at the end to see if anyone recognises who this is. As you can see, massive sales growth. So that's going to be quite costly. You can also see the SG&A expense went up quite a lot, but actually not quite as much as the sales growth went up. So that's going to be a bit of a negative here. We look at the cash flow from operations. It's negative against the reported, you've got -8.9 million, against reported net income of 82. This is going to be a problem, okay? So this is going to be penalised quite heavily in the score, because that's a massive accrual to be making. These are the way the scores come out. Those are the different indices at the bottom. And then if you follow the procedure through, this is the result we get. It's probably the highest M score we'll ever see. I mean, this is quite off the scale. So, I'm not sure I should ask anyone to name this company, but it's a useful piece of analysis. What that is telling you statistically, he doesn't actually say for what kind of this number would be. I'd say there's less than a 1% chance that this company is not manipulating its earnings in some way. And what will happen over the following 18-month period after that results, those results are published, is they will be restated. And they'll be restated very heavily, in all probability, unless it's that 1% miraculous sort of thing where actually this is all absolutely spot on. So enough on reptiles. Next category we have are birds. Now, characteristic of birds, and I'm going to make a distinction between birds and mammals here, and it's a little bit of a fine distinction maybe. The characteristic of birds is they lay eggs, and eggs, in the metaphor I'm using here, the eggs are really they characterise companies where you're having to keep them warm by pouring lots and lots of cash flow in before anything really appears that's going to be useful. And so, if you like, you're trusting that something is going to come out that's alive. You're pouring money into it. You're having to put lots of love and care and attention into this egg, and you're hoping it's going to deliver you what you thought it was going to do. If you like, it's a risky, uncomfortable period. It requires a lot of tender care and a good deal of affection to see one of these things through. But if you're successful and you hatch the chick, of course, and it survives its sort of early years, you get something that can travel incredibly quickly. So if you like, the prize of investing in birds is that they then fly very, very fast. And once they take off, you've got something that's really worth having. In contrast to which, let's talk about what kind of things do I mean by birds. Well, of course, you've got the classic thing would be a biotechnology stock is a classic bird. In fact, the problem with biotechnology stocks is they only really do eggs. And certainly in the UK sector, these things almost never hatch. And they're either going to sell out before they hatch, or they are not going to make it. And these are very fragile eggs, and they need a huge amount of money. And they're normally about 10-year gestation periods. So these are 10-year eggs. And 10-year eggs in stock markets are very, very difficult things. So the biotechnology sector in the UK just hasn't really worked, if we're honest about it. The government would love it to. I would love it to. I think there's some amazing people in that sector, some fantastic projects. It's been highly problematic on the stock market. But other things, mining companies are really, they're kind of birds. They're very big birds. But the problem with mining companies is that, they require this long period of exploration. You pour lots of money at, what is just a field. You start drilling it. You start employing expensive engineers to come and imagine what this could be like before you've done anything. And that's an egg. There are other sectors, technology hardware in particular, scientific discoveries, commercializing intellectual property. These are eggs, and some of them are much longer gestations than others. And of course, the ones, because at Amati we don't have massively deep pockets, we tend to try and finance. If we're going to finance something like this, we want it to be something that we really can see is going to be, well, we're probably going to wait till it hatches, frankly, but we can't deal with very, very long time frames of just continually throwing money at a particular project. And of course, sometimes, when it comes to the egg that never hatches, sometimes it turns out to be empty, sometimes it does hatch and a reptile comes out of it. That's really unpleasant. So the final category, mammals. Now, these are really the more conventional businesses, and these are companies which, when they're founded, they don't require a lot of capital. They can become profitable quite quickly. So these are going to be service-type businesses, traditional asset-intensive businesses, or maybe property companies where you're buying something that's immediately yielding. You're setting up a manufacturing facility, you can turn it on very fast. It's a service company, a bunch of engineers selling their services. These companies are relatively easy to get going. They require... what you saw earlier, actually, from AO is interesting in this respect because, the most successful of these companies are led by somebody incredibly dynamic who's thought of just a better way of doing something, a more efficient way. AO, what's interesting about that, it didn't require a lot of capital. And it didn't quite, he's probably made money in year one. And he could pay off his debts very quickly. And that's really, the excellence at that end of the market. And at this end, if you're investing in early stage mammals, if you like, excellence is really about having a visionary management team, managers who are passionate about what they do, who care about what they do. Those words that were being used in the earlier session, they're absolutely crucial to the best of breed of these sort of younger mammals, if you like. So take those categories, and as a good biologist, now what we're going to go on and do is look at the various sort of life cycles that happen on the market. This is important as well. And if you like, the earliest stage life cycle, I've got an illustration of it here, it's pie in the sky. It's really when you have an amazing idea, you've got this dream, and the challenge is, it feels like it's far away. Is it ever going to come down to earth? It's something that you want, it's something lots of people are going to want, but the challenge is, is this ever going to be realisable? And of course, if it's a bird kind of a business, it may stay in this category for really a long time. And if you're going to invest in that kind of thing, be realistic about it. Always add on a couple of extra years to any assumptions you're making, because typically those eggs take a long time to hatch. Think of AO when the idea for it was first mooted, it probably sounded a little bit crazy. How are you going to turn out the best delivery company for washing machines in the UK? This is a massively competitive market. How are you going to do it? It's an idea. It's a bit of vision. It's very exciting to invest at this stage in the company's life. So of course, it's risky as well. Just a couple of examples from our portfolio. This is a material science company on AIM. It's actually it's a bird. Okay, this has been an egg stage for a very long time. It was floated far too early, really, as a research company. that came out of Southampton University. It's got some really, really excellent science in it. It has preparatory techniques for using thin film technology for discovering new materials. More recently, they've got to the point where they've got something to commercialise, and it's a solid-state battery is the first product they're going to commercialise. It's still a long road, but because they hit that point of now we've got something to commercialise, from our point of view, that becomes an interesting stage, and it's a very small investment in our VCTs. It's not, because of the stage of life it is and because it's a bird, it's not something we could have to make a big investment in, but it's something that we found interesting to make a small investment in. Here's another one. This is a this is a marble company. It's based in Kosovo. So one might say, well, actually, is this an amphibian? Well, in some ways, yes. But because of that, when we invested in this company, I joined the board. And you know, one of the ways, you know, those categories of amphibian fish, it's all about how much you know about what you're dealing with. And joining the board, of course, is quite a good way to stay very well informed. This is a picture of a quarry that's about a year into development. And when you open one of these things, you can never really be sure that you're going to have a successful quarry. Fortunately, we've now opened four successful quarries. There are other challenges in the business, of course. Once you get getting the marble out of the ground, you've got to sell it. So we're into the phase of establishing a sales channel. Then when a company grows up a little bit more, it moves into this phase, which I call the best thing since sliced bread. So really, it's had a fantastic idea. It's got it off the ground. It's starting to earn revenue. So the egg, if you like, is hatched if it's a bird. Money's starting to come in. It's got a proposition that needs to go somewhere, and it's got something fabulous to sell or some new process, some best way of doing something. This is very exciting, still quite a fragile stage of a company's life. They're establishing their sales channels. They're establishing their culture as a business. They're proving themselves. And a few examples of these in the portfolio. This company should have got a lot further than it did earlier, and it's a company that we invested in initially, thinking it was had a nice proposition. It turned out to be a reptile. Actually, it had a really, the wrong management is maybe as much as I should say. If you're an active investor, as I know many of you are, you'll do what we did. We got kind of stuck into the company, talked to one of the other shareholders, changed the chairman. Still very often a good way of catalyzing change in a company. 3 months after we changed the chairman, he fired the chief executive, and then we had to rescue the business. And we thought it was worth rescuing, and we put in a convertible loan note, invested from the VCTs, invested alongside equity investors. And a number of years on, actually it's been a very good investment. And it's probably grown at a rate which is probably maybe a quarter of what we were hoping it would have done. But it's getting somewhere, and it's proving up its business. It's still in this stage of best thing since sliced bread. It's not yet moved on. We're hoping it will be able to move on. Microsaic, this is a pretty high-tech business. Had a very long gestation period. Floated, still really as an unhatched egg, if you like. It's all about commercializing this product. They've got a fantastic product. It's a liquid mass spectrometer. It's miniaturized, it's much cheaper than anything else you can buy. Liquid mass spectrometers normally require an air compressor. This one doesn't. It's using advanced semiconductor manufacturing techniques to miniaturize it. But it's a long road with anything like that. It might be a great new product, it might be much cheaper. Getting customers to change their behavior always takes a long time in a big industry. It's happening, it's happened quite slowly. It's still selling the best thing since sliced bread, but it hasn't yet managed to move on to that next stage. We think it will do, or maybe it will end up as a trade sale. Ubersense, here's another one. Company with lots of technology. It's a little bit of a hybrid. It's got one new business in it. It's got an older business in it. And this new business here is we call it an indoor GPS. So it's a piece of positioning technology which you can install in a car manufacturing plant, which is what you're seeing here, and it tracks exactly where the cars are in that factory. And as a car enters a particular area, you can see highlighted here in blue boxes, that car in the blue box, all the tools around it will automatically adjust so that they've got all the right settings for that particular car, and every car is different. So if you like, it's enabling the efficiency of that factory and to grow substantially, and it's reducing the number of errors that get made by people having the wrong torque on the spanner and so on. It's been adopted by really a very large number of the global car manufacturers. A couple more, I won't labour these too much. Mycelex, this is an oil filtration business. And again, they came up with a new filtering technology. It's for filtering water. It's called water polishing, where you take out the last residual element of oil from water so that you can then discard it back into the sea, or you can discharge it back into a river, or dispose of it safely. That last bit of water polishing was something which hasn't been very well tackled by the former technologies. Mycelex developed this some time ago. Oil is a massive industry. It moves very, very slowly. And this company is really all about the relatively early stages still of commercializing this to very, very large customers. And it's happening. It's not without its bumps in the road. But we think it's got a good business model and a very good product. Interestingly, Earthport. Now we see this is characteristic of quite a lot of situations that arise on the AIM market, where somebody has an idea that doesn't really work. Maybe a management team, you've got a good idea, but they're not really the right people to implement it. And over a long period of time, they throw a huge amount of money at a particular problem and get nowhere. And that's exactly what happened with Earthport. This, if you like, was a 10-year egg. It was worthy of a biotechnology stock. They were building a global money transferring system to enable you to use local banking infrastructure to send money internationally. So I don't know how often you've sent money abroad. In the old days, you'd just have to go and wire it abroad, and wiring was a very expensive, somewhat blind technology where you'd send the money over. You weren't quite sure when it was going to get there, how much was it going to get changed into when it did, and you got all those details later. Earthport spent many years trying to use the local banking money sending infrastructure to do international transfers. It's kind of a slightly complex problem to describe. It's also an incredibly difficult one to solve. And what happened was somebody invested in this business who happened to be a Goldman Sachs partner who'd left the business. And he didn't make many public market investments. He understood this area a little bit, put some money in, and didn't understand why it wasn't working. So he investigated more closely and ended up investing quite a lot more money in the business, joining the board, and firing all of the other directors bar none. That's very, very unusual that you change an entire board the way he changed the entire board of this. But he just realized they had completely the wrong board structure to make this work. But at the same time, he realized that some very important developments had happened in the US banking market. New legislation had come in, which was going to force banks to adopt the kind of infrastructure that Earthport has spent 10 years developing and which none of the banks had. And so, if you like, this has turned from being something which was really kind of at the egg stage refusing to hatch into something which suddenly has a product and a 10 years of investment in getting there, which was going to be in demand from very, very large customers. And they've signed up a significant number of the world's leading banks. And the reason they're signing them up is because they can't solve this particular problem for themselves, not quickly enough and not cheaply enough. So life cycle three, when the companies start to run a bit faster, that's when, you know, what they're then really bringing to the market and they'll talk to you as investors about is, we can do this better, we can do this something faster, and we can do it cheaper. And then you'll get very engaging and interesting presentations firing at these three things. And so at this stage, the company has reached, you know, a stage of relative maturity for the AIM market. You know, this is where we're hoping our company is going to end up. And just to whiz through a few examples, you'll see Spruegis, you'll be able to talk to them here. They sell fire smoke alarms and CO2 alarms. And they got, you know, they do it better, and they do it, I don't know if they do it faster, but they just make probably the products that people want in this particular marketplace. And they've got very good distribution to do that. Accesso, that was Tom Burnett, he presented earlier on. I don't know how many of you were at his presentation. Clearly, they've got the best product in the market for what they were doing. He was talking about ticketing being a business that he acquired into. They simply do that better than anyone else. So they've got the biggest market share, and they're growing fast as a result of it. Craneware, this is about saving US hospitals. It's about revenue management for US hospitals. They would argue they've got the best software in the market. It's probably, they don't want to argue it's the cheapest, but it's again, it's, a lot of the time we're talking about products which have a competitive advantage. This is the best. And that's, you know, very often our investment thesis in an AIM company is going to be based on that and correctly identifying or incorrectly identifying, can we believe that story? Is that really the best? And then we go away and do our homework and try and figure out, which again, it's not an easy thing to do because, you know, I'm not a manager of a US hospital. How do I know if Craneware's product is really the best? Or, you know, I'm not running a theme park attraction. How do I know if that ticketing solution is the best? These are the kind of challenges and bits of research that we have to become comfortable in doing as investors in the AIM market. Optimal Payments, it's another payments business. It's grown very quickly. Didn't have to make a massive investment to do it. It's payment processing. It's an e-wallet. iDocs, another software company that we are a holder of. Moving on to the next sort of life cycle category, I'm cheating a little bit because this is fundamentally a sort of different way of growing a business. And these are the roll-ups. So, or roll-outs, I should say. So if you've got a very good idea in a consumer-facing business or in maybe a services kind of business, and you can take a cookie-cutter approach, say, well, that worked brilliantly in Leicester. Let's go and do it in 100 other UK towns. And so you roll out your pilot project, and if it works, you're then going to go and do it again and again and again. And in a way, this rollout idea is exactly what you're seeing with AO going from the UK saying, this is brilliant, let's go and do it in Germany, let's go and do it in Austria. It's rolling out an idea. So just a few example we happen to own is Prezzo, it's a classic, it's a supermarket, it's a restaurant business that had a good format. Comes from, the chap who runs it is from a family of restaurant gurus. For some reason, this particular family seemed to have set up and successfully managed and sold, you know, a very large number of the pizza chains in the UK. This was one iteration. Belvoir, that's a lettings business, property lettings business. It's a rollout strategy. Brooks Macdonald, to a degree, became a rollout. It was a wealth management business, came up with a good model and decided to roll it out nationally, which it's done very successfully. So two more categories only. This one I've called the hand-me-downs, and this is an interesting category, and there aren't too many examples of this on AIM, because if you like, this is when we get to the stage where essentially what you're talking about is an asset, a business asset, which has enormous longevity in its value. And so if you like, these are probably businesses that have been around for a very, very long time. Probably the best, yeah, I can think of one reasonable example on AIM is Nichols, the drinks business, which owns Vimto. It's a brand that's been around for a very, very long time. They own it. It's a very valuable asset. It'd be a difficult one to destroy. It's got real longevity to it. It's probably going to be around in another 50 years' time. That's a hand-me-down, if you like. These are very, these are resilient. They don't necessarily grow astronomically fast. You wouldn't expect them to. Hopefully, the good ones will be growing, and maybe they'll grow 10% a year for a good company like this. There was a recent flotation, not on AIM, but on the full list, of the AA, which we liked a good deal, and we're an investor in the AA. That's a hand-me-down kind of asset. It's a 125-year-old brand. It's one of the best, most trusted brands in the UK, even though actually really the business has hardly been managed for the last decade. They haven't expanded their customer base at all. In fact, their insurance business has been declining. It was kind of put on the back burner by its former venture capital owner, and yet it's still thrown off massive amounts of cash flow every year. It's a hand-me-down kind of asset. And the final one, in the life cycle business, is really what I call Me Too. And I suppose what I'm getting at Me Toos are, these are not businesses where lots of other people do them. All businesses are competitive, and you can do very well by investing in a business that can operate in a competitive marketplace, but better than everyone else. A Me Too business is one that actually is no better than anyone else. If you like, it's a fake. It might come to you saying, oh, and normally these things arise when you get a bit of a fashion in the market and somebody does incredibly well with an idea and the stock goes up, you know, some ridiculous amount. And that causes a lot of people to think, hang on a minute, I could do that. And then, in fact, they know nothing about it, but they know how to put together something that looks a bit like it. And they bring it to market. And sometimes these things actually float. They're almost always, well, they are always disasters as investments, because you've got somebody who didn't have the idea, who doesn't have the passion. It's as if I now had the idea, oh, I could do what AO do. You know, I would stand no chance of doing that. I would just be a Me Too business. They're copycat businesses. I don't know how, if anyone remembers when, do you remember Autonomy, which sold itself to Hewlett Packard in great controversy? That business floated in 1998, and it floated on a market called ESDAC. And of course, when the dot-com boom happened, it was one of the darling stocks of the UK market. It got into the FTSE 100 briefly in the year 2000, and it had a meteoric rise. The shares were up 100-fold, and that was common in America. That was pretty unusual in the UK. And so, of course, it attracted Me Too businesses, and what they did was called knowledge management. So if like a whole little subsector on AIM appeared of knowledge management software, and all of the other companies were universally utter rubbish. But they were there, and people bought them because they thought, oh, that's the next Autonomy, I'll buy that one. And they're hoping that it's going to do the same thing again. These things don't. So beware of that. So just to reach some kind of conclusion on this elaborate journey I've taken you on, I've tried to come up with a zookeeper's handbook. So here we have the various types of animals and their life cycles over here. And I just kind of put together some scores as to, you know, how, where one, if you're running a portfolio of investments, how willing you might be to take on different categories and how risky they are. So here we go for fish. You know, basically fish are difficult, so we're not going to want to do very much of this, if at all. And if you do, you know, don't do pie in the sky fish. That's just way too difficult. Don't even do the best thing since sliced bread fish. Do the ones that got mature businesses, but do little of them and take care. Amphibians, well, you know, if you're going to engage with overseas markets and you're going to engage anywhere in the natural resources sector, you're going to end up doing amphibians. These are not impossible to do. Never do a Me Too one. So, you know, if, I don't know, the price of copper is going through the roof, you'll find a lot of companies float with a bit of ground somewhere or other way distant, and they're a copper explorer. You know, that's a Me Too business. Don't bother with that. You do sometimes have to do pie in the sky, I guess, because sometimes you'll be buying a mining company pre-production or an oil explorance company pre-production, but just make sure you're not not buying that too far ahead of when it's going to produce something. The reptiles, you want to avoid all of these. If you can avoid all of these, you'll do very well in your investments. You know, these are where we lose money, and you know, we all get caught out, but that should be a big area of our focus. Now, the birds. These are attractive, okay? But be careful of the egg stage. The eggs, because you don't know what's going to hatch, and you don't know how long it's going to take. But once they do hatch, they become very attractive. And particularly when you get them to that better, faster, cheaper stage, they're maturing as companies. You know, the reason they take a long time to hatch is because they got something very valuable, and they can grow fast, and they can also grow fast even when the economy isn't, because they brought something to the economy which wasn't there before. And then the mammals, this is just my view. I mean, I put these numbers together very quickly. I might take a different view on a different day. But, you know, you've got the hand-me-down assets that are very valuable. Having some of those in your portfolio is going to add a lot of solidity. They survive tough times. Always worth having some. For us, you know, we own the AA, as I said. We own Nichols. We own another stock called Dignity, which I see as a hand-me-down kind of asset. But, you know, rollouts and the more mature companies, these are very attractive. And this is why, actually, we think it's worth investing in the AIM market, these kind of categories where you can buy well-managed growth companies with distinctive propositions, high barriers to entry, well-capitalised, run by passionate people with integrity. That's why we keep going with this market, and why Doug and I and my other fund manager colleague in Edinburgh, David Stevenson, why we love investing in this space, why we're committed to doing it for pretty much for the rest of our careers, not got any plans to move to another area, and why I think and hope that you'll find it a very rewarding area to invest in as well. So thank you for your attention.